This is the Ender 3 V3 Plus, courtesy of Creality. It's exactly the same as the Ender 3 V3, only larger. And we'll get a closer look at it right after this. I'm Brian, and you are watching BV3D. This episode is sponsored by PCBWay. We'll talk more about them in just a bit. Hi, welcome back. Thanks to Creality for sending this Ender 3 V3 Plus to the channel so I could show it to you. We'll cover the specs, touch on assembly and setup, and take a look at some prints, and I'll let you know what I like and don't like about the printer. And if this video seems longer than usual, remember that you can use the chapter markers on the video's timeline to get to the parts you're most interested in. So let's jump right into the specs and features. The Ender 3 V3 Plus has a build volume of 300 millimeters on X and Y and 330 millimeters on Z. The X, Y, and Z axes ride on smooth rods and linear bearings instead of V-slot wheels. It has a Core XZ motion system on the gantry, which is like the Core XY motion system, just rotated 90 degrees. It has dual Y-axis motors to give it the power to sling the bed back and forth quickly. The bed has a textured magnetic spring steel sheet, making it easy to remove models when you're done printing. And the bed can get up to 100 degrees Celsius. The tool head has a direct drive extruder that feeds 1.75 millimeter filament down to a tri-metal nozzle that can get up to 300 degrees Celsius. The nozzle is actually a combined nozzle and heat break. It has a hardened steel tip and uses copper for good thermal conductivity with the heater core on the hot side and the heat sink on the cold side and titanium in between to help maintain thermal separation between the two. Between the hardened steel nozzle tip and the 300 degree maximum temperature, Creality says the printer supports printing PLA, TPU, PETG, ABS, and carbon fiber reinforced PLA and PETG. The tool head also has parts cooling blowers mounted front and back to help quickly cool the model that's being printed. From a speed perspective, it can move it up to 600 millimeters per second, with acceleration up to 20,000 millimeters per second squared. That said, I should note that the included slicer caps the speed at about 300 millimeters per second. It's running the Clipper-based Creality OS on a 32-bit mainboard. Thanks to its Clipper roots and a built-in accelerometer, it's got input shaping to help prevent ringing artifacts on prints when printing fast. It also has automatic mesh bed leveling and automatic Z offset calibration. The printer has Wi-Fi, so you can connect it to a Wi-Fi network and then use the Creality print slicing software to prepare 3D models for printing, send print jobs, and monitor the printer. Or you can save prepared files in G-code format to a USB flash drive, insert the flash drive in the printer, and print that way. The color touchscreen makes it easy to control and interact with the printer. It has power loss recovery, which will provide a bit of protection against power blips. And finally, it has a filament runout sensor, so it can let you know when you need to run out and get more. And that's it for the specs and features. This video is sponsored by PCBWay. PCBWay is known for making low-cost, high-quality printed circuit boards, but they also do CNC machining, 3D printing, sheet metal fabrication, and even injection molding. They sent me a few samples, and I gotta say, these circuit board rulers and coasters are freaking amazing. And the clear resin prints of the PCBWay logo, these are 100% crystal clear. So whether you need PCBs, machining services, or even something printed in a specialty material your printer can't handle, PCBWay can do that for you. Check them out at PCBWay.com. The printer ships partially disassembled, and putting it together is pretty easy. Creality includes all the necessary tools, plus a few for ongoing maintenance, including a nozzle unclogging tool, hex wrenches, a screwdriver, a nozzle wrench, grease, flush cutters, and zip ties. So, first, get all the parts out of the box. There are two layers of stuff. The first layer has the small user guide, the Z-axis braces, the spool holder pieces, the power cord, the screen, and the tools. The second layer has a small spool of filament, the X and Z gantry, and the printer base. With all the parts out of the box, put the spool holder together, then snap it to the right side of the gantry. Next, align the gantry with the base and set it in place. Bolt the gantry to the base using the included screws. There are two on the left front, two on the right front, and two more on the left and the right that go in from the bottom. After that, bolt the Z braces to the gantry. Bolt them to the bottom first, then to the top. One goes on the left side and one goes on the right side. The one for the right side has a cable clip on it and that should face outward. Now, plug in the cable connectors. There's this little one that goes to the X and Z limit switches at the top of the gantry. Then there are the X and Z motors. Also, clip the wiring harness into place when plugging in the filament sensor. And then plug the connector on the end of the harness into the socket on the top of the tool head. Use a zip tie to secure the cable to the strain relief, then snap on the cover. Slide the three cable clips onto the tube, then connect the tube to the hot end. Use the three clips to secure the wiring harness to the Bowden tube. This will help keep the wires out of the way. Plug the cable at the front of the printer into the touchscreen. Then snap the touchscreen onto the front of the printer. Then set the voltage input switch to match what comes out of your walls. Where I live, that's 115 volts, so that's what I set it to. Finally, remove the protective film from the screen. Many people like this step the best, and I understand why. It certainly has appeal. And with that, there you go. Now it's assembled. Next, let's power up the printer and go through the initial setup steps. Plug the printer into power, then turn it on. Once the printer has finished booting, select your language of choice on the touchscreen, then tap Next. Deal with the privacy policy, and then tap Next. Although I skipped this step, if you want to add the printer to a Wi-Fi network, pick the network and enter its password, then tap Next. Select your time zone and tap Next. And then start the self-test. This makes sure that the nozzle and the bed heat up like they're supposed to, and it tests the fans to make sure they're working as expected. It also calibrates input shaping, which will help reduce ringing artifacts on prints, and this step is a bit noisy since it vibrates the tool head and the bed at different frequencies to do what it needs to do. And it performs the mesh bed leveling step after that. When it finally gets done, tap OK. The whole first run process takes about 15 minutes to complete. Now that setup is done, let's load some filament and run a test print. We'll use the little 200 gram spool that came with the printer for this. Use the flush cutters to cut a 45 degree angle on the end of the filament. Mount the spool on the spool holder and start feeding the filament into the runout sensor. Push the filament all the way through the tube until it stops. Detach the tube from the hot end and slide the lever to the right to release pressure on the extruder gears to make it easier to insert the filament. Then guide the filament down into the extruder as far as you can and slide the lever to the right so the extruder gears grab onto the filament. Reconnect the tube to the extruder. Snap the kickstand looking thing onto the spool holder. Why? Well, when the printer homes the Z-axis, it goes all the way to the top, bringing some filament along with it. So this part helps prevent the filament from coming off the spool when the Z-axis comes back down to the bed. On the touchscreen, tap the second icon, the one that looks like three slider controls. In here, tap Extrude and Retract at the top of the screen, then tap the Extrude button. The printer will heat the nozzle. It'll take a minute or so, and once it reaches the set temperature, it'll extrude a bit of filament. So that's it for filament loading. Now that the filament is loaded, let's run a test print. Plug in the flash drive that came with the printer. Tap the folder icon on the touchscreen and select a model to print. I'll pick the traditional 3D Benchy and then tap Print. Then the printer will heat the bed and the nozzle and do its thing. And a short while later, I've got a Benchy. We'll get a closer look at this one and some other things that I printed in a few minutes. Hey, if you're getting something out of this video, or even if you just like 3D printing stuff in general, a subscribe would be awesome. That lets me know that I'm making content you enjoy and you want to see more like it. Thanks. Let's talk about slicing files. At the time of recording, Creality does not have printer profiles for the Ender 3 V3 Plus in the Creality Print Slicer software. I'm running the current version of it on macOS and it's just not there. The regular Ender 3 V3 is there though, so I saved a copy of it and renamed it Ender 3 V3 Plus. Since the two printers seem to be identical, except that the Plus has a larger build volume, I adjusted the build volume of the copy to match, 300 by 300 by 330. And although I skipped adding the printer to my Wi-Fi network during the initial setup, I did go back and configure that. With the printer on the network, I was able to scan for it and add it to the device tab in Creality Print. That gives me the ability to send print jobs directly from the slicer, as well as monitor the printer's status during the print. So to slice a model and print it, I'll load the model into Creality Print. There are two printing presets available, Quality, which uses a layer height of 0.2 millimeters, and Normal, which uses a layer height of 0.25 millimeters. I'll use the Quality preset and slice this Calicat model and send it to the printer with just a couple of clicks. And once it's been sent to print, the printer does what you'd expect with the end result being a Calicat. Okay, so now that we've seen the process of slicing and printing, let's take a look at some of the things that I printed. First up, here's that pre-sliced benchy that was included with the printer. This was the first print on this machine, and it was printed using the included small spool of PLA. And even though it's a speed benchy that printed in only 14 minutes, it looks really good. There are no cooling related issues that I can see, the surface finish looks pretty good, and there's not any stringing. That's a pretty impressive result. I remember the old days when a standard benchy was a 2-hour print and a fast benchy only took an hour and a half. Okay, next, this is a pre-sliced phone stand, also included with the printer. This one was also printed in the included white PLA, and it printed in an hour and 3 minutes. It turned out pretty good too. It's got print-in-place hinges that allow you to adjust the angle between 6 different positions or fold it flat for travel. The hinges work perfectly, and the only issue I really see is a little bit too much squish on that first layer. Everything else about it came out really good. This Calicat model is from Design over on Thingiverse. I sliced it using Creality Print and printed it in that same white PLA. It printed in 22 minutes. It looks good. The surface finish looks good, and I'm happy with how it turned out. When it started printing, I noticed the slicer included a brim around the two front feet. I wasn't expecting that. I don't normally use brims when I print Calicats, but I let it run instead of stopping and re-slicing. It's a good Calicat nonetheless, and I can always trim the brim off later. Now, here's a fidget cube by LaForest Labs on printables. This was also sliced in Creality Print, and I printed it in some matte blue filament from Filament. It printed in an hour and 4 minutes. Like the phone stand, this utilizes print-in-place hinges, so you don't have to assemble anything after printing. All the hinges work like they should, so you can spend the rest of your days folding this cube over and over on itself. Next, here's the articulated axolotl by AK Inferno on printables. It printed in under an hour, in just 57 minutes. This one is also printed in the matte blue filament. Like some of the previous models, this one's linked body segments also utilize a print-in-place design, so right off the build plate, it flexes and moves. There's no stringing here, and all the pieces move like they're supposed to. It's got a good surface finish, and like everything else I've printed so far, I think the printer did great. I saved the biggest print for last. This is the Extra Large Dragon Egg with Threads by Tony Youngblood on printables. I printed this one in Kermi Green filament from Protopasta. And as soon as I saw the finished print, holy guacamole, it reminded me more of the inside of an avocado than it did Kermit the Frog. Maybe it's the shape. It's gotta be the shape. This prints as two separate parts, and I got both of them on the build plate at the same time. It printed in 6 hours and 16 minutes. The two halves screw together so you can keep your treasures inside. What kind of treasures? Maybe gold, maybe candy, who knows? Print one, put stuff in it, and comment to let everyone know. I think this model came out pretty good, despite looking unexpectedly like an avocado. And that is it for the prints. Okay, so with the prints out of the way, I'll go over what I like and don't like about the printer, starting with the things I like. I like that print speed. This printer has done a really good job of cranking out good quality prints fast. I like the flex plate because it makes it easy to remove prints when they're finished, and it has alignment notches at the back to make it easy to get back in place. The touchscreen is easy to use and makes controlling the printer pretty easy. And I think that being able to send prints over Wi-Fi directly from the Creality print slicer and monitor print progress there too is pretty convenient. So that's it for the likes. Now here are the things that I don't like about it. The cable management issues that I noted in my Ender 3 V3 video persist with the Ender 3 V3 Plus. It's just really busy at the back right corner of the printer. Maybe even more so given the longer cables needed for a larger printer. And the filament kickstand thing is still kind of a requirement. Like the Ender 3 V3, the Plus homes at the top and unspools filament as it goes. Then when the tool head comes back down to the bed, that filament doesn't magically re-spool. The kickstand thing is there to try to keep a loop or two of filament from coming off the spool and getting tangled. The last thing I'm not super happy about is that the Creality print slicer that came on the flash drive with the printer is only a Windows version, and even that is pre-release beta software. The Mac version that you can download from Creality doesn't include the printer profile for the Plus. The downloadable Windows version may or may not, I don't know. So that's it for the dislikes. Now it's time to start wrapping things up. I mentioned the Creality print slicer in both the likes and the dislikes segments. Even though it's technically not part of the printer itself, it is the software that's creating the instructions for the printer to follow when printing a model. So it's definitely part of the overall experience of using the printer. And in that regard, at least from my point of view, Creality needs to make sure that the slicer has built-in profiles for the printer. Working around the issue was simple enough though, making a copy of the standard Ender 3 V3 profile, renaming it Ender 3 V3 Plus, and adjusting the build volume worked perfectly well. And credit where it's due, that slicer profile is really well tuned both for the Ender 3 V3 and the Ender 3 V3 Plus. Currently, the printer's listed on Creality's store at $479 US, which right now is $150 more than the regular Ender 3 V3, which appears to be on sale for $329. As far as I can tell, the only difference between the two is the build volume. So if you really like the Ender 3 V3, but you wish it was bigger, the Plus is probably the one for you. So that's the Creality Ender 3 V3 Plus. Thanks again to Creality for sending this to the channel so I could show it to you. Thank you for watching, and big thanks to everyone who supports the channel, whether with channel memberships or by using the links in the description. If you liked this episode, give it a thumbs up and maybe consider subscribing so you don't miss new ones. Well, 3D printing friends, that's about all the time we have for this one, and now that we're at the end, let's go print something cool.